The French Traveler. The scene was the Savant Club in the last years of the 19th century. Despite the extreme lateness of the hour, a few of the regulars were gathered there for cards and conversation. The latter turned, as it often does, to the uncanny. Said Nelson Hayes, one of the older members of the club, before retiring rather early thanks to an inheritance he'd been employed at the British Museum. I've heard a tale or two that'd chill the blood. Hazel Payton, late of West End fame, smiled thinly. Have you? Oh yes, even yours, Hayes insisted, smiling back despite perhaps a hint of asperity in his tone. Do tell, a new voice said from behind the old museum man. He started and then turned rather slowly. It was Miss Amelia Frost, the head of the inner circle. She nodded almost imperceptibly and gracefully took a seat that another one of the men at the table hastened to pull out for her. A round of heartfelt good evening and the like ensued. Tut, Miss Frost said. Silence instantly. Tell me a tale that will chill my blood, Mr. Hayes.
Yes, I know just the thing, Hayes said with evident relief. Yes, just the thing.
This was told to me some years ago, not long after I left the museum. Save Miss Frost, poised as always, everyone else at the table shifted and groaned. The story of Hayes' departure from the museum was so well known that any of them could have told it.
But of course, it's not that business I have to tell, Hayes was swift to assure them. No, no, this involves a certain inn in Warwickshire. It doesn't stand anymore, but it did, I believe, when I was told the story. The story itself took place in the days of George III.
In the days of George III, the Woodhouse was an inn along the road from Kenilworth to Solihull. Although well situated, it was not prosperous. Locals avoided it, and travelers generally found it expedient to press on to Temple Balsall or Balsall Common. Our protagonist is Sabine de Menier. She was a young Frenchwoman of noble birth who had decided, somewhat hastily, to take advantage of the healthy clime of England instead of enduring the Jacobin storm battering La Patrie. Mademoiselle Sabine was going to Solihull, where she had friends, but the rotten weather obligated her to stop rather than to continue to the former or even Temple Balsall. The hitherto silent driver of her coach suggested the Woodhouse. Lacking any knowledge of the district and, somewhat worse, the fear for sudden rain, Sabine acquiesced. Thus, she found herself in halting conversation with the innkeep, a rather Batrachian specimen. Neither spoke the King's English, as it was then, with great skill, but eventually it came across that lodgings were available. Perhaps not of the quality she was acquainted with, but respectable enough for a country inn, the proprietor promised after his fashion. Oh yes, Miss is in luck. There's a good room on the first floor. Ain't a proper hall, no, but still the best you'll find, that is a fact. Sabine had her doubts to the good innkeeper's honesty, but no doubts whatsoever that she had never stayed in such humble quarters. And whosoever shall exalt herself shall be abased, as scripture says. The room itself was a bare one, with bed, dresser, and what you might call a desk if you were feeling generous, and a chair to go with it. It was hardly fitting for one of Sabine's servants in the days when she had any, let alone a woman of high birth, and possessed only two features of note. The first was a lengthy phrase rather minutely carved into the lintel of the door. Sabine had to stand on tiptoes to read it, and even with the aid of a shabby oil lamp that she took from the pseudo-desk, it was rather inscrutable to her. "But wild beasts shall rest here, and their houses shall be filled with serpents, and ostriches shall dwell here, and ye hairy ones shall dance here." The second was a painting. It was in the style of the latter half of the 17th century and was a curious mixture of portrait and landscape. There was a woman in the foreground, dark all around, quite obviously some sort of Latin, although looking rather placid for that type. Behind her, forested hills, a dreary sort of river, and a setting sun. Nothing of great interest, you might suppose. There was no signature, but a plate at the bottom of the frame read, "Portrait of an Italian." Sabine made herself home as best she could. Once her belongings were all in place, she was ushered into a shabby sort of parlor. Supper, served by a near silent woman, was nothing more than warm soup and some slices of cold meat with a glass of vinegary wine to wash it down. All in all, it was, at best, just barely adequate to Sabine's needs. She was considerably homesick and quite abashed, and dearly wished for escape from this dreary fate. Returning to her room, the painting caught her eye. At first, it hadn't seemed very striking, but now, Sabine was somewhat entranced by the piece. There was something vivid, almost lifelike, in the Italian woman's eyes. Quite a fine bit of work for what had first seemed to be uninspired daub. She thought she'd never be able to fall asleep. However, aided by the strong and steady rain, she finally drifted off. It was the very stroke of 9 o'clock when Sabine woke suddenly, courtesy of the sound of a sigh. Or was it a sob? Naturally, our fair Frenchwoman looked around quite sharply, but there was no one to be seen. She'd sensibly locked the door when retiring for the night. Shabby as the room was, the door was sturdy. It would take prodigious strength to batter it down, and the windows were shut. It was unlikely that they had been opened since the reign of George II, and doubtful anyone unequipped with a pry bar could have done so by now. No, Sabine was quite secure. But wait, what was this? There was some curious magnifying or illuminating property to the moonlight, apparently, because looking at the painting now, hitherto hidden details could be seen. Dark figures, 4, perhaps 5, were now faintly visible behind the Italian woman. They were hard to make out in any detail, a great fault on the painter's part. Was he an amateur? Yes, quite likely. A country squire expressing talents he did not fully possess, no doubt. And as for the Italian, her expression was not placid so much as stoic, or perhaps resigned. It never occurred to Sabine that with the storm still raging, there could have been no moonlight whatsoever. She sat upright in bed for some time, staring at the painting, before sleep finally claimed her once more. But not for all that long. The clock struck 12 when Sabine was once again roused. This time, it was a cold puff against her neck. She slapped at her perfect throat, roused herself, and then looked around in confusion and no bit of fear. It had been as if someone had breathed on her. How could that be? There was certainly the feeling of some shadowy presence in the room. As hastily as she could, Sabine lit an oil lamp alongside her bed and was glad of the light cast upon the room through the glass, greasy and smudged though it was. Nothing. The windows were still shut, and the door still locked. The room was, Sabine aside, empty of any Christian souls, or so it seemed at first glance. Her gaze was irresistibly drawn to the painting which loomed so large in her room and her imagination alike. There were more tricks of the moonlight, which was even brighter now. It focused rather tightly upon that old picture. The dark figures loomed somewhat larger and clearer now. They were more or less of human proportions, if rather muscular, but covered in thick, tangled fur. There was also some strangeness about their legs. They were altogether too thin for such robust bodies, for one thing. And for another, there was something queer about the way they were bent. As for what still seemed the focal point of the painting, the Italian woman's resigned expression was not resigned at all, but clearly one of fright. Sabine gazed upon the ever-revelatory art for quite a while, fixated by it, before somehow again falling into slumber. A sigh, or sob, perhaps, in the room. An exhalation upon a lovely neck, and now a touch, feathery and warm, upon the same. It was now 3 in the morning. As before, so now, after the usual bout of dizzying terror and hastily confirming the room was empty, Sabine looked at the painting. What was this? Could it be? It couldn't, but it was. The woman in black was moving within the bounds of the frame. Her hands were pressed against the canvas as if seeking escape, and she uttered silent entreaties while tears streamed down her cheeks. Only a hard heart could have resisted such a silent entreaty, and Sabine's was soft as butter. She rose, her shift no doubt gleaming in the light of the moon or whatever it was, and crossed the room, bare feet making but the faintest noises upon the floorboards. There could be no doubt. The Italian woman, weeping and moaning, had both palms pressed flat against the canvas. It was a remarkable effect. Those pale hands seemed almost to pulse with the frantic force of her thumping heart. After a moment's hesitation on the principle, as it were, Sabine reached out to her imprisoned co-dweller. When her fingers passed through what should have been canvas, instead of pressing against said material, she gasped, and gasped again when the woman in black took hold of her wrists.
Ah, mon Dieu!
Sabine cried out. The grip of the Italian woman, no, the Italian specter, was cold and hard as iron. There was no escape. None whatsoever. Sabine was pulled headlong into that oh-so-curious painting. There was a moment of dizziness, threaded through with a mad laugh of relief and delivery. And then Sabine found herself on dry earth, pebbly and rough against her soft soles. She'd been turned around 180 degrees and was staring out at her dark, shabby room. All was nearly black as pitch. The moonlight, or whatever strange light, was gone. Naturally, she pounded against the canvas, but while it was clear as glass, it was as hard as stone. There was no escape that way. Sabine screamed and screamed again when hairy, tenebrous shapes clutched at her, took hold of her, and drew her back into the waiting darkness. But no sound was heard in the inn. In the morning, the innkeeper and his wife quietly disposed of Sabine's possessions. The driver's silence was, as usual, purchased with 2 guineas. The inn no longer stands, and the painting, described as Portrait of a French Woman, ended up, I believe, in the collection of the late Lord Atherstone. Miss Frost clapped, and so, of course, did all the others.
Thanks for watching, and before you go, here's a special shout out to my patrons who donated $20 or more.
Painty, Zestros,
Jane Ives, Fantasy Rider Cosplay, Dark Nito Taki, Avrock Levgri, Jesse, Kimimaro Kaguya, and Simon Loverdeer Delisle. Thanks so much, you guys. If you're interested in becoming a patron and helping me to keep YouTube creepy, please feel free to check out the link in the card.